I am Jana Newman, the National INM Manager for the Natural Resource Program Center here in Fort Collins of the Fish and Wildlife Service. And I really appreciate the opportunity to give a brief overview and intro of the Fish and Wildlife Service Inventory and Monitoring Initiative along with Soch. And I thank her for setting this up and asking me to do this. So I'm going to start this off and give an overview of what is the national perspective and the national portion of the inventory and monitoring, and then Soch will bring it down to the regional and local level and really closely to how it interacts, and we see ourselves collaborating with the LCCs and give a few specific examples on that. So again, just to make sure that we're kind of all on the same footing, I know that for many of you this is probably review, but we thought that we would start with just a general introduction to the National Wildlife Refuge System. Most people do live within a short drive of the refuge, which makes it certainly applicable to most of the Americans. I always like that kind of little fact. But the really interesting part of the National Wildlife System and the critical part of it from our standpoint is that it is America's only network of federal lands that are set aside for the conservation of wildlife. And that's a really unique aspect of it. But it helps that we can bring that conservation mission and those lands close to the American public. We currently have 556 national wildlife refuges, other units, and 38 wetland management districts. This actually speaks to the fact that we have such a large network of land that is specifically for the conservation of wildlife, speaks directly to the mission of the refuge system to manage this national network of lands, waters, for the conservation management and, where appropriate, restoration for the benefit of present and future generations of Americans. That takes us to our legacy, and our legacy goes back to 1903, which started with a German immigrant, Paul Krogel, who took an interest in the thousands of nesting brown pelicans on a five-acre mangrove island outside of the mainland of Florida, where he lived. And back then, there really weren't any laws to protect them. So he took it upon himself to go out there during nesting seasons and protect the pelicans. He did have friends in the conservation and ornithology arena that were friends of Teddy Roosevelt. So without a lot of fanfare, on March 14th, 1903, Teddy Roosevelt established the first federal bird reservation on Pelican Island. He would then later go on to establish 55 reservations and game preserves, which was the beginning of the National Wildlife Refuge System. We've grown since then. There are many things kind of throughout the past 100 years that have grown the system. Some of the major legislation or the major eras of system growth are listed there. The early refuge lands, that was the Teddy Roosevelt kind of era. Migratory bird refuges was a large commitment to adding lands to the National Wildlife Refuge System. It established the Migratory Bird Conservation Commission that actually approved land to be purchased by monies collected by the sale of federal duck stamps. And so that act is often referred to as the Duck Stamp Act. And it's still, today, the sale of those duck stamps still supports the growth of the refuge system. 1935, as you all know, was some of the worst storms of the Dust Bowl era. And that also kind of ushered in another era of conservation that resulted in the establishment of 63 refuges that were dedicated to not only wildlife habitat, but to the reversal of environmental degradation, another large pivotal movement in the establishment of the refuge system. Then we've had since then the Land and Water Conservation Fund Act that added more lands, but the Alaska National Wildlife Refuges were brought on with ANILCA that then added them also to the system. So legislative mandates for the refuge system, early on there were not a lot. There was not a comprehensive legislative mandate for the refuge system. And it did lead to some pressures and how to, local management issues of how to run various refuges. So a pivotal act was the National Wildlife Refuge Administration Act of 1966. And that really was one of the first acts that gave us, that told us that we had to manage for uses that were actually compatible with what the original refuge was established for. It also, at that time, it also added a lot of waterfowl protection areas to the refuge system. And these are areas that grasslands and wetlands, obviously critical to waterfowl and other wildlife habitat. As good as that act was, Congress did feel that it needed to be improved, and we had the National Wildlife Refuge System Improvement Act of 1997, and it improved that 1966 act by amending it to include a unifying mission, which is to require that we act singularly as a system and that we be focused on wildlife conservation. That's a large change and a large way of looking at things, to actually think of the 556 refuges that we have as one unified system instead of individual entities. Along with that, it mandated that we have planning, conservation, comprehensive conservation plans that look out over a 15-year time span. The Refuge Act also, the Improvement Act also mandated other things, but this last one is one that really leads us into inventory and monitoring and the establishment of this initiative, which is the need or the mandate to monitor the status and trends of fish and wildlife and plants in each refuge. I'm going to let that sit for a minute, and I'm going to say it again. To monitor the status and trends of fish, wildlife, and plants in each refuge. That is obviously a big charge. It's something that no agency can actually go alone, and especially if we're acting as a system, we recognized that we can't act independently anymore. We have to act as a unified refuge system, but we also have to act as a global conservation community. That in order to understand conservation, not only within the National Wildlife Refuge System and how those refuges work together as a system, but how those refuges fit into the larger landscape. So how we are operating and how each system, how each refuge operates within the ecosystem and taking into an ecosystem perspective. For that, we realized that we really do need to work together as a conservation community. So Fish and Wildlife Service took this to heart and in 2010 stood up the Natural Resource Program Center. The unifying mission of the Program Center is to integrate science, all science, biological, physical, and social sciences into our planning, into our biological planning within the Fish and Wildlife Service. So it was stood up originally with two branches, inventory and monitoring and water resources, and we've recently added the branch of air quality and human dimensions, filling out that charter to join all of the sciences into our biological planning. So the center, the Science Center, is responsible for ensuring the credible interdisciplinary scientific information is available and part of our refuge system planning and management activities. So I'll go a little bit more into this, again, diving down a little bit deeper, starting big picture and kind of funneling down. So the inventory and monitoring initiative, which is the focus of today's talk, integrates that science to inform biological planning and integrates biological science. We really see ourselves on the of that strategic habitat conservation wheel as in the outcome-based monitoring. So we understand what monitoring has occurred. We understand what science is going on. We integrate that. We use that to form inform biological planning. And the Fish and Wildlife Service vision for conserving the future calls for a robust inventory and monitoring effort that is nationally coordinated, and that is really the focus of the national effort here in Fort Collins, is to make sure that the initiative, while also regionally based and speaks to the refuges themselves and speaks to local land management needs, also has a larger, bigger picture focus to be nationally coordinated and to help provide that larger landscape and ecosystem view. The funding sources, the original funding for the NRPC was congressional appropriation to inform the adaptation strategies of climate change. And we see our primary customers as not only internal to the Fish and Wildlife Service, the planning, the fisheries, and migratory birds that we work with and collaborate, but external conservation partners such as LCCs and joint ventures, universities, state tribes. So we are see that we're working and to collaborate with all of those efforts. So the how is INM structured here within the Fish and Wildlife Service? As I mentioned, there is a national breadth to it, and then also a regional kind of perspective of it. And within the national, here in Fort Collins, we have a national manager, myself, and then a data management team and a science team as well that works with us. And we work with then 8 regional INM coordinators. So we have the regional structure with the regional coordinators and data managers. And then, again, taking that down into a finer scale, we have proposed a zone system that has been adopted by the Refuge system as being a way to bring a lot of the focused needs down into the refuges and down to the local areas themselves. And there's about, we're recommending about 4 to 5 zones per region. Those zones are loosely connected with the LCCs and should coordinate and collaborate with that with the LCCs. So that's really kind of a nexus for the LCCs to the Fish and Wildlife Service INM effort. And within each zone, there are zone biologists, data managers, and field biologists of various numbers depending on the zone and on the regions. And Soch is going to speak a lot more to this specific and how this is work, how this is structured within Region 6. So what does the National Wildlife Refuge System INM do? What can you expect us to do? Well, we have a lot of things that we do, and they're listed there. Mostly we are nationally coordinated. This is what we want you to remember, is that we are, again, hearkening back to that we need to have the refuge system be unified into one system and not an entity of 556 refuges. We do bring a landscape focus to our assessments and our analyses and our planning. Our job is to gather, synthesize, and serve up this information to the various customers that we have, planning and working with the LCCs. We develop decision support tools. But a lot of focus of this office is also to leverage the resources of key partners, so to make sure that we're not being redundant and duplicative, and to be good stewards of public funds. We have many national priorities in the past 2 years since we've been established. They're listed there. We're really going to focus on probably the top 5 of those in this presentation. So the service catalog, one of the first the first 5 are pretty much all databases. Some of them are being constructed in-house, but a lot of them we're doing through partnerships. So data information system, that has been a really large effort in the first few years of the INM. And the reason for that is because it is essential to working as a larger system and coordinating efforts and collaborating both within the refuge system, within the Fish and Wildlife Service, and external to other agencies. It is the management and control and serving up of information in a efficient manner that will make this program successful. So our data information system is where we've put a lot of our effort at the very beginning, and we learned that from one of the partners that we partner with here in Fort Collins, the Park Service and USGS, that getting that data information system is right from the beginning. So we have, this is sort of our large vision of what the data information system will ultimately look like. The central circle there is what we call IRIS, which is kind of our eye or looking into control of everything. We have a lot of databases that will feed into that, starting from kind of the orange that is on your left, the INM survey planning primer. We're going to talk about that. That's a survey of surveys. Then a service catalog, which stores legacy data. Other information systems come into that, WRIAs, species databases, other web services, as well as bring all that information from that is within INM into one central portal, the IRIS, and then use that to feed that out and collaborate and create products that we can then send out to our collaborative partners, as well as use that information system down the road one day to perhaps hook into other information systems. So the service catalog, this was a really vital part of beginning, is that we recognize that there's a lot of information out there in Fish and Wildlife Service and within the refuge system that is stored in filing cabinets and is kept within the refuge itself and is not necessarily accessible to other people that would want to collaborate. It also makes it difficult for planning efforts because they would have to go to the refuges themselves to get those documents. So the service catalog, or ServCat, as we like to call it, is just that. It is a repository for the refuge literature and for all service literature, for the gray literature, for documents, data sets, spatial, geospatial files. It is centrally served so that it will have access to everybody first within Fish and Wildlife Service, then we will connect to a similar data store information that the Park Service has, and we will also have a portal that will be part of that, will be accessible to the public, so other people will be able to search our records as well. We will also store protocols out there. It will be fully documented, so it's easily discoverable and retrievable. We did a pilot last year that went out to 10 refuges, and through that pilot, we successfully uploaded over 2,000 documents. We learned a lot from that, and now we're working on an implementation strategy to roll out uniformly so that there are a lot of documents, as you can imagine, within refuges, stored within a lot of rooms. And the idea is what we have to do is strategically figure out how we're going to get the most important documents into the system first in a way that is efficient and that allows it to be used, is not a big burden on the people that have to upload those documents into it, and does it in a manner where we prioritize the documents and start with those that are most important to planning as well as refuge management needs first. Primer, the planning and review of INM on refuges. We sometimes refer to this as the survey of surveys, or as the first sentence has there, it is the who, what, why, and when of current and ongoing surveys. We will also eventually get to legacy surveys within that as well. The idea was that before we can start, we have to inventory it. The inventory not only of what is on our lands, but the inventory of what inventorying we have done in the past. So the survey of surveys, hence. And so, in other words, what have we got? Who is doing what? And a lot of times, for collaborative purposes and for working even within a region and a landscape level, it's important to know what surveys have been conducted and what surveys are ongoing so that you can collaborate with other people and know if they've already got a protocol or how they're doing it. And so having this information in a centrally localized data information system is going to be critical to improving our collaboration within the service as well as external with partners. It will also streamline many of our planning processes because we'll already know what surveys are being conducted and at what level within the system. Water quality monitoring, this is actually one of the areas where we're very closely collaborating with the Water Resource Branch here in the Science Center. And as part of this initiative, we are working with them to begin the beginning of water quality and quantity as a nationally coordinated effort across the refuge system. We're also implementing a water resource inventory and assessment data information system. And what that will do is it will, they, as part of that, it's a storage for the assessments of and water rights, water-related infrastructure, water monitoring information. All of that information through will be assessed and will be cataloged and will be stored within the water information, the WRIA, the database for that. And that information will then be available for searching from within the refuges as well as other areas that when people come in and want to do management, we have that information all nicely available for them. Phenology. Well, phenology is obviously the indicator, and it is influenced by seasonal variations in climate, so it's an indicator of climate change. EPA has included several phenological events in their set of climate change indicators. Phenology is certainly something that we should be monitoring uniformly across the refuge system. It is currently monitored, probably on many refuges within the system. The issue is that we don't necessarily know whether it's being monitored uniformly, and we don't have a centralized data information system where that phenological information is being stored. There is a centralized database that has already been established with USGS. The USA National Phenological Network has a large database with already established protocols on it. Fish and Wildlife Service, INM, has made the decision that we will partner and collaborate with them rather than inventing our own protocols, that we will work with them. Park Service is also working with USANPN, so this is a large collaborative effort across 8 bureaus and within the refuge system. It will allow the phenological data that we're collecting to not only be useful within the refuge system, but to also be part of the larger network, and will be able to be used in analyses that are larger in breadth than just the refuge system itself. It's going to allow the assessment of the phenological data on a larger spatial and temporal scale. So we're very excited to be working on this. And one of the first things that we're doing is we're assessing what phenological information is collected on the refuge system. And we are also working with USANPN to put a portal specifically for the refuge system to use, which will make their access and use of this system easier for them. So what will the National INM do? We've talked about our beginnings, and then we've talked about what we're doing now. Where do we see ourselves going? Well, we will have the full-scale implementation of our data information system. We now are beginning through a new policy within the Fish and Wildlife Service that we're working on, the development of inventory monitoring plans. And those plans are, we see, as very essential to standardizing protocols, to helping us understand what surveys are being done, and to help work within the planning and the management of the refuges themselves. We need to develop a species database and species occurrence list. We need to have a place where we can have centrally located the lists, just lists of species that we know that occurs on refuge lands. We need to begin developing core monitoring metrics across the refuge system, and to begin developing ways to assess status and trends of our refuge lands. So in the end, what does the inventory and monitoring initiative provide? Well, we provide credible interdisciplinary scientific information to inform biological planning at multiple scales. That's essentially it in a nutshell. We are a nationally coordinated effort, and we look to provide that biological information both within the refuge system as well as working with external partners. And with that, before I turn it over to Soch, I think that there may be some time for some questions.
Hey, and we do have a timeline, a question from Lori Simmons about the timeline. And Lori would like to know, what is the timeline for completing all these components?
Well, the ones that I spoke about are just a few of the components that we are working on, and each one has somewhat of an individual component. So the timeline for getting ServCat centralized is this summer, the end of this summer, beginning of September. We already have an in-house version that we're using, and to get all of the documents imported that we would need into ServCat is obviously going to be a long-term effort. There are a tremendous amount of legacy documents stored out on the refuges, and that is a large process to get those put in. We do hope to, we are going to meet in August and prioritize which of those documents should be put in. We already have a lot of documents within ServCat, but we recognize that for the relevancy of it, it needs to be strategically implemented, and that is a long-term effort. For the surveys primer, to get that information in, again, to have that system centralized and available, we're still targeting the end of September, early October for that. We did do a pilot of that last year, and we have a lot of information from that pilot that we will roll in and put into that system once it goes live and centralized. The input of information about the surveys into Primer is something that will probably occur as each of the refuges work through their inventory and monitoring plans. At that time will be a very good and efficient time for them to get that survey information in, although each region may have a different timeline for that. I think those are some of the more specific ones that I talked about.
Great.
Many of these products that we're working on doesn't really have a timeline to finish or whatever. I think like uploading ServCat and using Primer and things, it's just going to be an iterative process. So it'll be just part of the way we do things.
Going forward, for sure, yeah.
Okay. Great, thank you. And it doesn't look like there are any other questions, so we're ready for part two.
All right, well, great. And I don't know how many folks know about the 8 regions in the service, and I just want to reiterate what Jana had said, that the Improvement Act charged the Fish and Wildlife Service to work as a system, the National Wildlife Refuge System. And I think with the onset of LCCs, I think there's great opportunities to do that because we are trying to work as a system, but we've met many, challenges and things like that. So with the LCCs, I think they'll give us really great opportunities. And speaking for myself, I'm really excited about how we work together on this. So anyway, Region 6 is the Mountain Prairie region, and it covers these 8 states. And this map that's on the screen now shows which LCCs are in our region. And as Jana said earlier, the Fish and Wildlife within the INM program adopted this the zone concept. And within our zone, we don't have all the positions filled. We're in the process of filling some of them, but we do have... I'm the regional coordinator, and I'm in Denver, basically, and Wayne King is our chief of division. We have Jeff Warren, who is a zone biologist, and he's stationed at Red Rocks and Red Rock Lakes, and he's in the Great Northern and Great Basin LCC. And each of the zone biologists have states that are they're responsible for as far as serving supporting the field stations and working with partners in the LCC. So Jeff Warren is up in the mountain states. Cammie Dixon is our zone biologist in the prairie state. She has South Dakota and North Dakota, and she's in the Plains and Prairie Pothole LCC. Murray Wabon is in Kansas, and he has he's in the Great Plains and Southern Rockies, and he has Nebraska, Kansas, and Colorado refuges. And then we have two database managers who are also stationed at the field. Joanne Dolan is at Ben Lake, and Jen Dorn is at Black Refuge. So, and you know, we although it's a zone concept, we do cross boundaries, so it's, the zones are pretty loose. So we work together really well. So anyway, so that's our staff for the region. And each of the region is set up a little bit differently. The number of staff can be different. So not every region in the Fish and Wildlife Service is set up this way. We're getting there. So. And then right now we are in the process of hiring a spatial analyst. And that person will be stationed here in Lakewood. And then a biometrician. This position announcement just went out and it's still open. So if you're interested in and the biometrician, it's still open all the time. So we'll add those two positions to our team, and that the biometrician will be located in Fort Collins, but they work for Region 6. So and what did we do for the first couple of years? So the INM initiative started basically in 2010, but we didn't get our staff all hired until 2011, and we focused on basically getting to know the field stations, our first customers. So we wanted to also gather information on what's being done as far as biology and science and what needs to be done, what are their priorities. So along with that, we conducted inventory monitoring reviews, so getting all the information that the stations have been doing, current surveys, past surveys, and research projects that they're working on, and identifying information and data gaps, and also identifying inventory, monitoring, and research needs that they the field stations have. So in the process of doing that, we want the field stations to be thinking about linking their goals and objectives to these comprehensive conservation plans. And these plans, and I just want to say a couple of things about these plans. It was a charge by the Improvement Act of 1997 that each of the field stations, refuge system, and the refuge system has to develop a CCP. And that CCP basically gives the refuge direction for the next 15 years. And so that so we're mandated to do that and to carry out the goals and objectives in the CCP. And it goes through a NEPA process, so it's a pretty extensive planning process. That identifies not only biology, but everything about the refuge, the refuge management. So we want each field station to link what they do to these goals and objectives that were identified in these plans. So as a result, we do have a list of things that are important to each of the field station and a compilation of the field stations within the zone. So. As you can see, I mean, it's pretty obvious that the Dakota Zone, prairie management and noxious weeds, prairie reconstruction, are really important topics that they'd like us to help them with. The Southern Zone, which is what Murray's doing in Kansas and Colorado and Nebraska, they want help with setting good biological objectives as they're developing their CCPs and habitat management plans. That's what HMP is. And also management advice and monitoring protocols. They need help with data analysis is a huge need, so that's why we're hiring a biometrician. In the Northern Zone, which Jeff serves, and that's where the Great Northern LCC is, their main issue is wetland and upland management and monitoring. And also they need help to analyze existing data. And although we've been really good about collecting information on species and habitats, we haven't been very good at integrating those two components. So that needs to be done, and they recognize that needs to be done, and that's their priority up there. So the other accomplishments that we've had is working with CCPs, habitat management plans. We're in the process of helping stations with a bunch of, it takes a lot of time, so that's why we're, for the first couple of years, we've only been working on a few. At the same time as doing the habitat management plans, we are working on inventory monitoring plans as well. So inventory monitoring plans should address directly the objectives that were identified in the CCP and the HMP. So another thing that we've been busy with is helping stations to do hydrogeomorphic analysis. And these are looking at the landscape within the refuge or within a watershed that the refuge is located on, looking at what was historically there as far as the landscape, ecosystems, what's been modified. A lot of our refuges have been drastically modified, whether, you know, we put dikes or plowed land to, you know, plant agriculture and things like that. So we look at what was modified, and then we do an assessment of what is possible, given what was there and what is there now, and what is the future potential of this land. So that's what a an HGM assessment is. And those are very costly. We do that as a contract. We've been helping stations with that. Another thing that's been keeping us busy for the last couple of years is developing a process to do requests for proposals, because we do have funds to spend on projects. And I just want to breeze through the steps that we did. We developed an online database. Basically, we call it a form that's on our SharePoint site. And the open season for RFP is continuous. There's really not a cutoff point, but we do have, throughout the year, as funding comes through, we do have cutoff points. So, for instance, for fiscal year 12, we had a cutoff date of December 15. But then if we had funding left over, we would go back to the database and look at what other proposals have been submitted since, and we may, you know, we go through the review process for those. So that's why it's kind of open. And who is eligible? We want to focus this this money towards refuge or management district management questions. So they are they have to work with partners, and the proposals have to be submitted through a refuge staff. And the ranking criteria, we had fatal flaws. Like I said before, getting the stations to address their goals and objectives that were identified in the CCP is very important. So that if the proposal didn't address those, it was, you know, it didn't go any further. It must have collaboration with refuge and district staff. So, for instance, if another program or if a partner is interested in doing work with the refuge or on the refuge, they can do that. They can collaborate. But right now we want to have the refuge staff to be fully engaged, and they should be the person who's submitting the proposal. And then we also want to make sure that the data that are collected during on these projects are, follow our Fish and Wildlife Protocol for data management. So we want data management very important to us. So those are the three fatal flaws. And the other qualities that we, criteria that we used to rank proposals were, you know, basic scientific stuff, good objectives, the designs and methods meet the objectives, and the funding and geographic scale is appropriate. Another thing we had as a criteria, and they get points for addressing regional priorities and national priorities, and also partner priorities, so LCCs and joint venture, migratory birds and stuff like that also get incorporated into the RFP process. And for FY12, we had a budget of about close to $1 million, and we received, I think it's been updated to about 50 proposals, and we funded 36 proposals that emptied our bank, basically. And they were in the green. It's just some examples of what came through and got funded. So anyway, we encourage people to resubmit if they didn't get funding. And the submission process, we have external subject experts to review these. It doesn't matter where they are or who they are, as long as they're expert in the topic they we ask them to review. And we give the submitters feedback of, you know, the reviewers' comments and also our comments. So it's a good learning process for us and for them as well. So, but just to summarize, what we did for the past 2 years is we wanted to do a needs assessment, basically, on what the station's priorities and needs are, and that's just to engage and communicate with them. And also, a big part of that is to build trust and credibility, and also to provide support. We've been helping them to do study designs and build databases and things like that. And we wanted to focus on this because we don't want the field station staff to view us as being a burden. We're very sensitive to asking their time for their time and things like that, and we want to make sure that they understand that we are their support staff. So that's why, you know, it's taking us quite a while to focus on building this trust and credibility with field staff. And then at the same time, we met with a number of fish and wildlife programs to talk about cross-program integration. And basically, the end product of this cross-program integration is to provide the best scientific and most comprehensive information for the field stations and also for the programs to meet, to inform our planning process and to make better management decisions. So we are continuing to work on this. I'm working on a white paper to do that. That's internal fish and wildlife stuff. And then now we are starting to think more about how we collaborate with our partners, which means primarily the LCC. So how do we coordinate and collaborate and integrate? We've been thinking a little about this, and we just want to give some examples of perhaps ways and just open up for discussion with you folks about how we can collaborate better. But, you know, just a couple of things that we've been sort of opportunistically taking advantage of as far as collaborating with LCCs is that we've been working with the Plains and Prairie Pothole LCC on Native Prairie Adaptive Management Project. That's a really great landscape, large landscape, multiple stations, and we'd like to add partners to this project. I've been working on developing a framework to conserve grassland habitat, and this effort started off with a workshop last September, and it's working with LCCs and a bunch of other partners, including universities, to come up with a framework to work together on conserving grassland habitat at a large landscape scale, and this mostly is kind of being initiated by the geographic area that's east of the Rockies. So we kind of want to start there first. So that could be a whole other webinar. If folks are interested, we can give that some other time. And then INM staff are serving on technical advisory and science teams, especially the zone biologists. And we've provided some consultation of various projects. So these are mostly sort of opportunistic, ad hoc efforts. And so what we need is a more strategic, less opportunistic, less crisis management way of collaborating. And I'm going to transition into perhaps some, you know, just a proposal on some ideas on how we might be able to work together. And I want to show you that last October, I coordinated a group of fish and wildlife assistant regional directors to talk about how we can identify conservation and science needs within the service itself, because we have so many different programs within the service. And we've been working together relatively well, but more opportunistic, and we don't have a strategic way to work together and sort of get ahead of the ball game. So a group of us came and together, and we kind of developed a skeleton of a framework, and this is still in draft, and I just want to show this to you, just as an idea of perhaps we can connect LCC and other partners to this framework. So Fish and Wildlife has our mission, which is, you know, in general, is to perpetuate and sustain fish and wildlife population and habitats. It's just a general paraphrasing. And then, like I said before, a little bit earlier, we have these different programs. So we have the Refuge program, which INM is is housed under. And then we have fisheries, migratory birds, ecological services, and so on and so forth. And then for each of these programs, we have assistant regional directors, that's ARDs, and they're part of the regional director team. So the INM, again, is part of the refuge program. And we have field stations, fisheries, and refuges especially have field stations. Ecological services also have field stations out there that serve geographic areas or refuges. So now we need to figure out what are the priorities, program priorities and science needs for each of these programs. And in order to do that, these programs need to talk to their constituents or their customers, basically their field stations, right? And then within the region, we also have the regional director's priorities, and they may be larger landscape or larger, more general priorities. So we need to identify these priorities and science needs for each of the programs, and we do need a process to do that for each of the programs. But once we have that identified, we would talk to a science team, and this is just a proposal, that each region would have this science team that makes up, that is represented by program representatives and LCC reps, and it would be chaired by the science ARD, science application ARD. And once the priorities are passed through the science team, the science team members would identify what are the common needs across the regions, across each region, and what are more specific program priorities and science needs for each of the programs. So once we have these common needs, we can actually talk to our partner in a unified, from one message from the Fish and Wildlife Service that these are our priorities and needs, and how do we get those addressed? So these common needs would be communicated through the science team, through the tech advisory team, and the steering committee, and it would go into this the LCC priorities. So, and we assume that the partners would, go through a similar process. We can't tell them what to do or whatever, and we don't know how they do that. But the partners also contribute their common priority needs to the LCCs as well. So how does that translate to what INM does, which is what this webinar is about? INM is sort of a special deal because we are part of this refuge program. It's a tiny part, and we're new. And we have a seat on the science team, or we should. And we also serve directly to the field stations because we have our zones and we have our field biologists. And so we deal directly with the field stations and also the regions. We work with other programs, like I mentioned before. But it doesn't, it doesn't preclude us from just focusing on this. Once the LCC identify the common priorities across all the partners, we can work together within the regional staff and also the national INM staff to address LCC priorities. So that's just an idea for further discussion. And this box, gray box, is other partners. We all have other partners that we've been working with and we should work with, continue to work with in the future. And that's outside of the LCC. So we have that at the field stations, and we have that with an INM and also with the partners as well. So that's just an idea to think about. So the most important thing is, how do we get these common needs from the agencies to the LCCs, and then how do we parcel out and prioritize what we work on with INM? So I hope that makes sense. So anyway, and the social and cultural thing is a black box, because it's been, we can't do this without bringing the human dimensions in. And it's been a challenge, and we need to address that further, and that still needs to be developed. So that's one proposal. So this puzzle here, is how do we work together? We have LCC that were, you know, the Great Northern, for instance, sort of parceled out into three forums, and we can talk about that a little more. National INM priorities, and regional cross-program priorities, and that makes up the common thing that we all can have share duties and leverage resources. So that's as an example, and maybe just a start. And this is something that Jan and I just talked about a couple of days ago, because we're still trying to figure out how do we work together with the LCCs and with partners at the same time, trying to keep grounded, you know, at the field station. So perhaps starting small would be one idea. And I've kind of been out of the loop with the Great Northern LCC, so perhaps these ideas have been discussed and whatever, and we can talk about that. So the Great Northern has these forums. They divide into three forums based on ecotypes. And for each of the forums, you've identified the ecosystem processes that need to be addressed, habitat and ecosystem types that are within the forum. And then the species, target species, have also been identified. So these are sort of the conservation targets for each of the forum. And in the strategic plan, this was done for the other two as well. So just taking a stage step as an example. So if we deconstruct what we need to do within the stage step forum or ecosystem, we can identify what is it about, and these habitat types, they were identified by the in table four, which I just showed earlier. So I'm just going to focus on sage scrub just to illustrate this example. So within the sage step and sage shrub habitat type, what is it that we need to do? What decisions do we need to make? Do we need to increase our protection by acquiring land and signing folks up for easements? And do we need to restore a lot of these areas that we have protected, but they need to be restored back to their native habitats or communities? Or do we just simply need to maintain them by controlling invasive species and things like that? Or do we need to do law enforcement? So what decisions do we need to make? So and then we can figure out, well, okay, so what needs to be done, and what has been done. So basically doing an assessment of what is out there. And then this is just to show you that these are the species that are conservation targets within stage step. And then if we deconstruct what we need to do, well, within the forum, we will find out what our needs are and what our data gaps are. And then that way we can figure out, we basically can divide and conquer of, you know, who's going to do what and what products are already out there and what new ones need to be developed to address what decisions we have to make. So anyway, these are nothing new. It's just a way to illustrate how we can perhaps move forward and to start with something small. And it's a little bit more strategic, and I think that's what we need. And I view this as sort of a step-down plan from the draft strategic plan. It basically addresses what that diagram just showed, you know, what decision needs to be done and what are the data gaps and things like that. And then at the same time, we can start this community of practice where it would last for a longer term and addresses common needs and interests. So that's one idea. And like I said, perhaps this has been talked about already and I just haven't heard it yet. So in the meantime, we can talk about what existing products that that may be useful that can serve our needs based on what we've just gone through. And And, you know, INM has IRIS, this data portal. The LCC has LC Maps. We know that Park Service has IRMA. And we don't know, well, at least I don't know what the other agencies have, but how, you know, how do we integrate these existing products so that it would serve partnership better with as we go forward. So that's really all I have. I brought those things up, and Jana and I did, for just to start off a discussion on how we can collaborate and where do we start from here, because we're really are interested and really excited to work together, but we haven't figured out how to, you know, a good way to move forward. So that's really the end of my slides, and we can open up for discussion and questions.
Great. Thank you much. Thank you very much. We had a very nice, you have a nice comment here from Sean Finn. He said, great example, with lots of exclamation points. So, okay, so we do have a question. Okay. Let's see. From the Prairie Plains and Potholes LCC, it's been great to work closely with the talented staff associated with INM. Thank you. And this is from Mike Olson. Will the results of your various annual research projects be written up and located at a central website that is accessible to our numerous partners, such as IRIS?
Yes. So right now, until IRIS is centralized, we have those in our regional database. So CERCAT isn't. Jana, correct me if I'm wrong. I think those reports and the results will eventually be in CERCAT.
Right, that's correct. And CERCAT has kind of couple of stages of implementation, so it's live now. We'll be live for refuge system personnel centrally located probably within a month to a month and a half. Then Park Service. Then we hope to sometime next year be able to have a external portal where then all the partners can reach those documents that are on it. And we would encourage the regions to put those annual reports. We're kind of beginning the mantra that if you're writing a report now, it's not actually finished until it gets uploaded into CERCAT.
Great, thank you. We have another question from Peter Drach. He would like to know, is this INM effort confined to the refuges, or is it intended to serve the whole service?
We are, I guess, how we look at it now, as we started, we are within the refuge system, and we are focused right now on refuge system, and we are focused on that, but refuge-centric, but not refuge-exclusive. So we do intend, especially for CERCAT, we see applicability within the service and INM as well. But our initial focus has right now been within the refuge system.
Yeah, and I just want to add something to that. I think that we all know that that although, you know, our primary customer is the refuge staff, we all know, even the refuge staff know, that they can't really manage just within their boundaries. So many people are looking outside of boundary and working with partnerships and talking to the planning chief here in our region. David Lucas is really interested in for the next generation of these comprehensive conservation plans, which starts in 2013. That's next year. So it starts next year. He is looking to do these plans at a larger landscape scale. So having the refuge be anchored, but also looking outside of what is the contribution of this refuge to the larger landscape community. So we're getting there, and we can't do that without working with our partners. I mean, I think we will fail if we don't work with our partners, and we will fail if we don't serve our refuge system and connect the two. So,
right, and I agree that it is looking out and trying to make sure that the refuge data and information is part of
the greater ecosystem assessments. And phenology is one of the first places where we're also taking a step in that to information that's already being collected on the refuges, making that available to the larger conservation community so that assessments extend beyond the boundaries of the refuge.
Great. And a follow-up comment from Rick Soja on this issue is, a key issue is to think about how individual refuges fit in the scope of landscape processes and connectivity, e.g. among birds, groundwater resources, and the like. How do we foster thinking about this integration in terms of LCCs? So he's wondering how we foster this thinking about this integration in terms of the LCCs. Perhaps you can follow up with Rick on that.
So that was a question. That was a question from Rick then.
I think so.
I totally agree that we do need to be connected as far, you know, from the ground up, talking about ecosystem processes and looking beyond, counting birds and things like that. So I think that's why the working at the larger landscape scale is so key to what we do. And I don't know how we get there. I mean, maybe the example is to start small and go through the process of deconstructing a high priority need within one LCC first, or a number of LCCs. I don't know, but I think we need to start small and sort of test the process of working together, you know, and addressing this, all these restoration and maintenance of habitats are, you can't do that without looking at ecosystem processes. I'm not sure if I'm answering Rick's question, but I think I know where he's coming from.
I think it's institutionalizing the idea and the thought process within everyone that works on biological data or all data, that data needs to when it can serve two masters, it has a local, we need to be able to address local questions, and we need to make sure that we can have data that we can address for landscape issues, and institutionalizing that idea that what we do matters beyond our boundaries.
Great. And then Sean Finn has a follow-up question. He says, I enjoyed this discussion on rolling up the science needs priorities from refuge stations to region to partnerships. Are there examples or pilots that we can look to for guidance?
For this, Sean, we just came up with this sort of proposal framework, and as far as I know, we don't really have good examples. I mean, the INM staff, since we got started a year or so ago, we are doing this now with our station visits. So we actually went to each of the field stations and asked them what their needs are, and that's where the list of our priorities in each zone came from. And from that, we have a regional list of conservation priorities and science needs from our refuges, you know, from all of our field stations. As far as I know, the other programs haven't done that. The participants of this workshop who came up with this idea, we presented it, presented the framework and communicated with our leadership and various other people. And it seems like everybody who's heard this supports it, but it hasn't been implemented. So it's sort of still in draft form. And so that's just talking about internal stuff. Jana and I sort of added this INM component, how we see things and how we could work with partners. And we are the INM initiative are in a process of developing a 7-year operational plan, and in that plan, we'll talk about how we do all of this.
You're absolutely correct, Soch. I mean, that's a very good example. And not only within the region, so I&M is sort of trying to blaze the trail on this, I guess, is that within the region, you went and met with each of the refuges and you rolled up within the region what your priorities are. Then we'll meet together for that 7-year plan and we'll kind of again roll up on a national perspective what those priorities are and come to look for where the commonalities are across regions for things that we can work on from a national effort and other things that come into that we may need to do, that we might say have to be looked at from a national effort and that we need help with. Getting that information up to the LCC is such that this is sort of a draft concept of how we would do that. We can have conversations individually with each LCC and walk through that step as Soch laid out in the next slide individually, but to figure out how all the partners then can work together with one particular LCC, the LCC needs to kind of pull that together and then bring that information back down to us kind of in this deconstruction that Soch had shown. But we don't really have an example of it going through that whole process. But a pilot would be interesting to do that.
Yeah, and I don't know if I don't want to speak for Nina, but yeah. Nina and Jana and I have been in sort of communication about how we might do this because we're the Great Northern is very interested in working with INM and refuges and stuff like that. And one thing I want to keep in mind is that, you know, INM is this new kid on the block, just like LCC, we're sort of the point program that's been I don't want to say picked on,
identified
of how we can work together. You know, it's always like it's always INM. How is INM integrating with these various fish and wildlife programs, and also how is INM working with LCCs? But at the same time, we have these really well-established programs within the Fish and Wildlife Service, and I'm sure that that's how, you know, the other agencies are structured as well. They have these various programs. So the more important thing is how does INM and these other programs, fisheries, migratory bird, ecological services, the JV, how can they contribute to the partnership? You know, and we can ask the same thing about the other agencies. How can I don't want to you know, because there's only so many staff and money INM, but we tend to kind of forget about these other programs and partners. So anyway, I just want to kind of emphasize that.
Great. Well, that looks like all the questions. And again, if anybody has any lingering questions, I encourage them to email the both of you. And I'm sure that is agreeable.
Yes.
Great.
Absolutely.
Good. Well, thank you so much.
Okay.